Welcome back, friends. In this video presentation, we'll be studying the alcoholic beverages preparation, and especially we'll be talking about whiskey. We have seen different alcoholic beverages preparation like wines, and we have also seen beers. Now, the preparation process for whiskey will be very much similar to that of beer. The only difference that they are having is in their one single step, and that is called the distillation. Because in case of beer, we don't go through distillation, but in case of whiskey, it requires distillation process, because in whiskey it is intended to have a high percentage of alcohol. Okay, so if that is the reason, that's why we need to distill our beverage. Okay, so let me change this color, otherwise it will be difficult. Okay, so for increment of the alcohol concentration in our alcoholic beverage like whiskey, we need to distill it. So distillation required. Except for that, the whole rest of the process will be extremely similar that of beer preparation, right? And I also remind you that if you want to study beer or whiskey preparation, just go through one of these videos, and I personally recommend this video. You can understand the preparation of beer, and then one extra step for the distillation for the whiskey. So let's begin. Now, what is whiskey? Now, whiskey usually spelled whiskey in Canada and Scotland, because it is previously developed in Scotland and Canada. Actually, in Scotland it was called a Scotch whiskey, right? Now, it is a spirit produced form of fermented grain and aged in the wood. That's the basic thing. It is a fermented food product, obviously fermented product of the grain. So we take grain as a source material. It is as we take grain as a polysaccharide or carbohydrate source material, and it is aged in wooden barrels, because when they are aged in the wooden barrels, the wooden barrel itself adds some kind of flavor to this whiskey. Okay, now it is simply spirit. That means usually the percentage of alcohol is very much higher, like above 30 to 40, or in fact 50% of the alcohol. So you can imagine how much alcoholic that beverage is. Now, usually most of the whiskies do not contain any kind of extra sweetness or flavor. It's simply having that alcohol percentage, right? But when they are aged in the wooden barrels, some extra flavors are sometimes added. Okay. Now, what is a spirit? A spirit is an alcoholic beverage with the alcohol content has been increased by distillation. That's where the new step came in for the whiskey preparation. Because for beer, the alcohol percentage was very, very low. It was just like 5 or maximum 6% or 8%. But in case of whiskey, we need to increase it to up to 30 to 50%. So for that purpose, we need to distill our water and alcohol sample so that we collect more of this alcohol and less of the water, so that we can make this dense alcoholic beverage. Okay, now other different types of whiskey can be brandy, rum, vodka, and all these things. Gin is also a type of whiskey. Now, usually brandy is prepared from distilled wine, rum is prepared from the sugarcane juice or molasses, vodka is prepared from grain but not aged. That's the difference between vodka and whiskey. If somebody asks you what is the difference between whiskey and vodka, you can tell that whiskey is something which is after preparation aged in wooden barrels, but vodka is also a spirit, but it is also produced from grain fermentation, but it is not aged. Okay, and a gin is also a distilled product from the grain and engaged, but flavored with juniper berries. That's the difference between gin, because it is slightly bit flavored along with the high alcohol content. Okay, so these are the variations of one with another. Okay, now the whiskey name came from the Irish Gaelic usage. So actually it means water of life. Water of life, and it was previously developed in Scotland, and their traditional whiskey coming from Scotland, which is aged for longer period of time, is called the Scotch whiskey, which is very expensive too. Okay, so let us talk about the types of whiskey. Now, the types of whiskey can be three major types here. One is a malt whiskey, then the grain whiskey, and then the blended Scotch. Now, in the malt whiskey, it indicates that the raw material is barley malt. That means we take the barley and we allow the barley to be converted into malt via the process called malting. Okay, and in this case, when the barley produce malt, now the malt is taken as the polysaccharide material and it is subjected for the fermentation, and then it is fermented, then the product is distilled, and we get our malt whiskey. Now for the grain whiskey, it indicates the contrast that what we require in this case is unmalted barley. Simple grains without the malting. So we simply take the barley as the grain material and we turn this barley into our alcoholic beverage. Now the third kind is a blended scotch. Now this one is completely different because in this case it is not directly prepared, because blended scotch is simply made using blending technique. That means for making this blended scotch, what we require many variety of a whiskey. So let's say whiskey variety 1, whiskey variety 2, whiskey variety 3, and what we do actually, we take up whiskies in a particular concentration and amount and we put them together to make this blending. Right, this process is called the blending, and there are blenders, scotch blenders are there which accomplish this task and which take up different variety of whiskey and mix them together to find a new unique kind of flavored whiskey. Okay, and it is commonly about 40% of malt and 60% of grain is kind of chosen, and a good quality blend may contain more than 40% malt, right? Okay. So now let's talk about the whiskey manufacturing unit, and especially we'll be talking about the malt whiskey, that is this part. Okay, so we'll be talking about malt whiskey, not the grain whiskey, because mostly the whiskey is prepared from malts. So let us talk about it. So for the malt whiskey, and this process of whiskey preparation is very much similar, just like the beer preparation. So if you find this okay with, then you can know the beer preparation too. So rest of this, whatever process we are going to talk about, this page will be extremely similar with the beer preparation. So here what we are doing, we take the barley and what we put the barley in water, and for the moisture content, to supply the moisture content, because the barley will require moisture to develop into what we called a malt, and this process is called the germination. We all know plant seeds germinate. There's a similar way that barley seeds germinate into the malt. Now once they're germinated into the malt, what we need to do, we need to dry them to remove the excess moisture out. So what we do, we just put it in the kiln. It is called the malt kiln, and the process of drying is called the kiln drying process. Now we just spread them into this floor usually, and we slightly hot climate so that the water evaporates and we get a slightly less moisture containing malt. Usually at this stage the malt contains 4% of the moisture. Okay, and at the very beginning it must contain 40 to 45% of the moisture. So the moisture is getting reduced. Okay, so once the moisture is getting reduced, we take this dried malt and we put them into the malt crushing bin, and then we crush it, we make the dressing, and what we get is a malt meal, and we produce the crisps. So it's a dust powder of the malt. Now once we get this dust powder of the malt, we take it and we mix it with hot water in a tun. It is called the mashing tun, and the step will be called as mashing. Now in this case what we do, we add our crisps or the dry powder of the malts into this tun, and we also add some hot water there, and then what we add, we also add some other ingredient which is called hops. Now we know hops is a typical ingredient which is giving the characteristic flavor to the beer, and also it is also added in case of whiskey making. So we add hops there and in the mashing tun, and mashing is done in this region. So in this mashing tun, what is going on is that malt flavors are coming out, hop flavors are coming out, and everything is kind of mixed up. Now after this mixed up, what we need to do, we need to separate the liquid from the solid parts. So we have a screening process, and after the screening what we get is called the liquid part. It is called the wort. Now in this wort, what we are having, mostly liquid parts. So we are having water, and we are also having the polysaccharide or carbohydrates that are coming from the malts. So as it is containing high level of carbohydrate, that's why it is a little bit sweeter. So we can also call it a sweet wort. Okay, so once we get this sweet wort, we take this and we put it into the fermentation tank. But before putting it into the fermentation tank, we need to wash it off. So after washing, we will put them in the fermentation tank, and once we put them in the fermentation tank, we'll be adding yeast from outside, because this yeast will be necessary for the fermentation. They will ferment all this carbohydrate that is present in this wort, and convert them into alcohol. So these are the three stages here that we have discussed. First is the malting, second one is the mashing, and third one is the fermentation. So now let's talk about fermentation more. So once after the fermentation is properly done and the alcohol is prepared, now actually the major process of conversion of sugar into alcohol done in this fermentation stage. But before this stage we need to go through several rounds, and after this stage also we need to look for several rounds. So here after the fermentation is done, we need move to the fourth stage, and that is called the distillation, which is the extra stage that is not present in beer preparation. I remind you, from this malting, mashing and fermentation, all of these three stages are common for beer preparation as well as for whiskey preparation. But for this fourth stage, which is the distillation, this is kind of different for beer to this whiskey, because this is only present. So this is only present in whiskey preparation, but not in beer preparation. Okay, so we put them in for this distillation, and how we take them and we put them in the copper tunnel. So that's how the copper tunnel actually looks. So it's a copper tube like that. We are going to see detailed images of all of these places. It is just like this funnel like model, and why it is like so, because this is a kind of distiller, right? So we heat this copper tun. So as we heat this, so this will heated this will be heated, and in this case actually there is mixture of alcohol and water, right? Now what we need to do using distillation, we need to take up more alcohol and less water. So alcohol is present, water is present. Now if we are heating it, we know that alcohol, the evaporation and the temperature for alcohol to evaporate is almost like 74.6 or 76. So I don't remember the correct value, 74 to 76 degrees Celsius. But for water to boil, it requires 100 degrees Celsius. So using this important task, what we do, we just heat them for 76 degrees Celsius temperature. As a result, alcohol start to evaporate and they are going to be collected. So alcohol is getting collected in the collecting chamber, and water remains there, right? So once we get this alcohol, we again repeat this task for several times. So after repeating it several times, we get concentrated alcohol from it. Okay, that's how the distillation takes place. So that's why you can see this tunnel is kind of as it is going in the top, it is kind of narrower. Why? Because this alcohol requires to be evaporated. So as it is evaporating just by going it, and then it is coming down, and the temperature is also going down. So here the temperature is high, and as we are moving at this direction, the temperature is low. So as it is lowering down the temperature, this alcohol is now become condensed, and then this condensed alcohol will be collected here as safe. Now this alcohol, which is having slightly impurities of water and slight concentrated alcohol, is called the low wine. Okay, now once we get this low wine, we again required for it to be still for further round of distillation. So for this part, we again subject it for the distillation, and in this case again it will be collected in spirit reservoir. Now once we repeat this step for twice and thrice, we get almost like 40% of alcohol in our solution, in our mixture. So we'll be happy with this 40% of alcohol, and we take it. And what we do now after this distillation process, we need to cool this. And how can we cool it? We cool it using a different cooling tunnels are there, and we cool this mixture. And after this cooling, we subject this for the aging. And for this aging, what we need to do, we can age this using warehousing or using barrels. Now using, most of the time it used barrels. So you can see here the cakes, that means these are all the barrels. These are the wooden barrels. So let me tell you, these are the wooden barrels. Wooden barrels are required because wooden barrels add some wooden flavors, because most of the flavor in the whiskey, which is very few, but most of the flavors are added from the wood where it resides for the aging. Okay, so flavors are coming out from the wood, and usually it is aged for 2 to 3 years. Okay, that's it. Now for the beer preparation, we don't require this aging process. We simply take it out and supply it. We can age it if you want, but most of the time it is not taken. But for the whiskey, this aging is very, very necessary. without the aging, whiskey is not that good and it is not consumed. Okay, so these two stages are unique to whiskey preparation, which is not found in beer preparation. Rest of it, the previous stages are all common. Now, once we are we age this whiskey, now the future downstreaming process, that means filling the bottles, leveling them, and then selling all those. Okay. Now, if we look at the Scotland, which is a large large whiskey preparing unit, actually 5 different whiskey producing regions can be designated by looking at them. Okay, and what are they? One is lowland, then highland. So you can see here different islands are present there, just like that. So this is lowland and this is highland. So major regions are lowlands and highlands. Except for that, we are having Campbelltown, and we are having islands of Islay, and also we are having Speyside. Okay, so these are the different regions of Scotland which are very much important in producing whiskies. Okay, so let's move on. So we have seen the different 7 stages for the whiskey preparation, right? For usually the malt whiskey preparation. First is the malting, then kilning, then milling, then mashing, fermenting, distillation, maturation. Actually, if we divide it, you don't require to memorize 7. Usually, I'm making it less. So, first is the malting, second stage is the mashing, third stage is the fermentation. These 3 are common for beer as well as whiskey. And then the unit for whiskey, fourth is distillation, and fifth is warehousing or maturation. So, these are the major 5 stages for the whiskey preparation. Okay. And there was major 3 ways for the beer preparation, right? Now let us talk about the detailed stages of each of these detailed stages, each of these 7 detailed stages for the whiskey preparation. So let us talk. So the first stage is a malting. Now malting means the germination of barley. So it simply means germination. So let me write germination of barley. Right, germination of barley, and barley requires water for this germination. So we need to increase the moisture content. Almost 40 to 45% of moisture is required. Now, once we get this percent of moisture, the barley will soak the water and they will start the germination. Now, usually, all of the necessary task for the germination is brought about by the hormone gibberellin that is secreted from this barley seeds, and once it is done, what it produces and all of these starches that is present inside the barley is now converted into sugar. That's why we require malting. If we don't require malting, if we don't process the barley into the malt, what will happen? So it simply take barley. Now barley usually contains polysaccharide like starch. Okay, like starch. Now, if we direct subject it for this fermentation, microorganisms may not be able to convert all of this starch, may not be able to. First, microorganisms need to break down the starch into simple form of sugar, which is glucose or simple sugar. Simple sugar, let me write. Then they need to convert them into the alcohol, right? So, if we provide them the starch, it requires a new step to be done, and that is to convert the starch into sugar then into alcohol. But if we directly put simple sugar, the process will be pretty fast because it requires only one direct stage, and that is the conversion of sugar into alcohol. That's the reason we want to provide them simple sugar. Okay, and how it will be done? If the barley is converted to malt, all the starch that are present inside barley is now converted into this simple form of sugar, and then those sugar can be used to directly ferment into the alcohol, right? Okay, so let's move on. Now the second process is called the kilning or kiln drying. Once after the germination is done, what we need require is to reduce the moisture content, because for the future stages we don't require that much of moisture present in the malt. So for that reason we need to dry them. Now, usually we can dry them using smoke dry process, right? And we call those malts after the germination as green malts, because roots and rootlets are kind of coming out now, and we require this kiln drying to stop the germination and also to prevent the sugar being used for growing. Now, if we allow this malt to grow after a certain date limit, after a certain time limit, what it will do? Germination will take place. Let's say this is a malt and trees, plants is kind of coming out, root is kind of coming out. So if you allow them to grow, they're kind of taking up all the sugars from themselves and they start to grow into tree like that. But we don't require that, we don't want it. So for that reason, to block this particular phase, we need to dry them, and also we need to stop this germination process, right? So for this process, we need to require this drying, and we usually dry them using smoke drying process or simply putting them into the large ground and heating that part. So you can see here, malts are kind of scattered in this whole ground as a large place, large hall, and is kind of drying. Okay, hot air is kind of passed. Now the third stage is the milling. Now in this stage, the barley malts are grinded and produce what is called the powder, and the powder of the malts are called grists. Okay, so malts powder are called grists, and in this case 65% of them is made up with husks, 25% are made up with middle, and 10% is made up with flour. So that's the constitution of a grist. Okay, so here it is the chamber, which is the milling chamber, where everything is a kind of grinded and it produces the grist, and we require this grist for the mashing. Okay, so now once we produce this grist, now what we do, we mix this grist with hot water. Now the water temperature usually is 80 degrees Celsius. Okay, usually 80 to 85 degrees Celsius. Now you put this water, this hot water, you mix it with the grist, and then what we put them in the mash tun, because the process will be called mashing. In this case, we put them in. Now why we require this mashing? We put this hot water so that all this sugary materials that is present inside those dust or powder of malt is kind of coming out into this water. That's why you require hot water, because if you put cold water, it may not be able to extract all the sugars. So that's why you put hot water, so that all the rest of the sugars that are present in the grist will come out into this water. Okay, and once everything is coming out into the water, so what we are doing, we are having this grist and we put them into water, and what it is doing, it is actually taking up all this carbohydrates or sugar into water. So now the water is mixed with sugar. As it is having with simple sugar in it, it is tasting like, it usually tastes like sweet, and we call them sweet wort or simply as wort. Okay, now the fifth stage, and the fifth stage is the fermentation process. Now in this fermentation, this is the major step for converting that sugar into alcohol, right? So we transfer our wort, which is now slightly warm, so we need to cool that wort, because prior to fermentation we need to cool them. Now we cool this wort a little bit, and then what we do, we take this wort and we put them into the wash bags. In this case, in this wash bags, and distiller's yeast is added. Now why we call distiller's yeast? Because this yeast what we take is not the wild type yeast, it is modified. That's very, very important. It is modified. Modified in such a way that it will provide us maximum yield in the less time and proper fermentation ability. Okay, so we take that kind of defined modified yeast and we add them into the wort. Right, now the yeast may be added in the form of new or never used yeast. So there can be two different type of mashing methods that can be available before the fermentation will begin, and those two fermentation process, one of them is called as the sweet mash method, another one is called as the sour mash method. In the sweet mash method, what we do in this case, what we take totally new, completely new form of yeast or never used yeast. Okay, so the yeast, which is also modified strain, but we never used it before, just unpack the box and we can add the yeast, and the process will be called as the sweet mash method. But if for this to occur, we need to have a higher temperature. So we need to put the fermentation in almost 25 to 27 degrees Celsius temperature to speed up the fermentation. As the yeasts are new, it requires some time to habituate in the environment for the fermenting ability. That's why we need to increase the temperature. But there is another process, and that is called the sour mash method. In the sour mash method, we use used yeast instead of new yeast. That means, let's say if we run this fermentation in batches, let's say this is the first batch. Now after the fermentation is done, yeasts are kind of settled down. Now we can take out those settled down yeast and we can use, so we can simply reuse those yeasts. Now reusing those yeast found to be more effective, because we can simply run this fermentation in room temperature, because they are accustomed to this environment, they are ready for the fermentation and everything is going on, and it's a low pH is also required, and the low pH promotes the yeast growth and it also inhibits the growth of bacteria. So this process is good. The sour mash method is good than the sweet mash method. Okay. So after the fermentation is done, what we get? We now get alcohol, a particular percentage, plus water, which is also present in particular amount. Now usually the alcohol we get is very less in this case. Okay, now what we need to produce? We need to produce a very high quality spirit, which will almost contain 70 to 80% of the spirit, right? So what we can do? We take this wash and it is transferred into wash region and we heat them into 80 degrees Celsius. So as we are heating them into 80 degrees Celsius, I remind you that this alcohol is having the boiling temperature of almost 74 or 76 degrees Celsius temperature. So if we heat them in 80 degrees Celsius temperature, alcohol starts to evaporate, and then what we do, we store this alcohol, right? So here you can see the copper tons, right? So copper tunnel like that, simply resembling the cartoon picture that you've seen previously, right? So here it is the controlling segment and the copper tun. Now usually this step is done in copper tun, not in the steel containers. The logic for that is that this copper may act as enzymatic reaction or enzyme cofactors during the process. So it can also help them to provide some more effect of fermentation and also the quality of wine spirit increases. Okay, so for that reason we usually take copper. Now the shape of these tanks are very important, as I have already discussed about it, that as the alcohol is going towards the top direction, it is kind of getting cooled and condensed, so that we can collect it in the in chambers. You can see here it is attached to chambers, we can directly collect it in the chambers. And once we get this alcohol after first distillation, we call those as low wines. Okay, and we require further rounds of distillation there. Okay, so what we can see here, so as the mixture of alcohol and water is a kind of azeotropic mixture, and in this case the temperature or the boiling temperature of alcohol is 78. I was mistaken, I told 74 or 76, actually it is 78 degrees Celsius temperature. So as we are heating the mixture, the whole mixture is at 80 degrees Celsius, first the alcohol is kind of evaporated and then they are condensed and stored, then the waters are evaporated. So we won't allow the water to evaporate, because before that for water to evaporate it requires almost 100 degrees Celsius and more than 100 degrees Celsius temperature, but we are actually heating them in 80 degrees Celsius temperature. That allows us to separate alcohol from the water, and that's the process called the distillation, right? Now if it contains more than 95% of alcohol, it will have no flavor, because no sugars will be remained. Now after the fermentation is done, now that's another very important concept, that when we need to stop the fermentation, that means we are having sugar in and fermentation is going on and alcohol is producing alcohol. Now if we allow this, all the sugars that are present, to be fermented into alcohol, we don't have any sweetness in our alcohol, right? Because everything is converted to the alcohol and no sugars left. Now usually there are some other materials like sugar and water and mixture of alcohol, and those other materials except for the alcohols are called as congeners. That means sugar, excess sugar and water, right? Now if we require more concentrated alcohol, like 95% and above 90% of alcohol, In those case, we may need to convert all the sugars into alcohol. Otherwise, we won't get that high concentration, right? So if we are converting all the sugars into alcohol, we are end up with no congeners there, only alcohols. Now, in those case, that kind of product is termed as grain neutral spirit. That means it is not having any trace of grain there. Simple spirit. But this high concentration of, or this high percentage of alcohol is not taken as for consumption. It is injurious for health. So usually this kind of things are taken for the spirit to burn and all these purposes. Okay. Now let us talk about the seventh stage, and that is the maturation. Now Scotch spirit is stored in the matured in oak cask, usually wooden barrels, as you can see, beautiful looking wooden barrels, and they are put there in usually in the dark and moisture chamber, dark and wet regions, so that wet, dark and cool regions, so they absorb the water and become less alcoholic. That's the reason to store them in the dark region. But usually the usual Scotch whiskey require at least 3 years for this aging. Then we take this Scotch out and then they sell them. Okay. Now during this processing, this oak barrels add some extra flavor to the whiskey, and the actual coloration, that's very important. The coloration that we observe, the color of this golden yellow or the color of dark yellow or brown achieved during this time of aging. Okay. Now the bottling. Now the glass is always used to store mature whiskey because it does not react with it. So that's why we require always glass containers for it. And modern distillers use automated machines to fill these bottles. As you can see, the machine is there, and which is actually filling all these bottles, and then the corking will be done. So everything is nowadays are automated. And after the whiskey is prepared, it's subject to slight level of pasteurization, and we can sell them. Okay, now we have till that point we have talked about the malt whiskey. Now just talk about a little bit about the grain whiskey. Since other grains are used, they are first cooked and then used in the malted barley with the malted barley. Right? Usually the grain whiskey doesn't mean the whole whiskey is made up with grains. Usually the grain whiskey is prepared with 60% of grain and 40% of malt, because malt is required, otherwise the organisms won't get desired form of sugar, right? So that's the reason. But if you take grain, you need to cook them first, otherwise all the starchy material that is present in grain won't be converted into sugar. And if you don't allow your organism to grow in simple sugar, they won't be able to ferment. Right, so these are the important concepts. And distillation is carried out in continuous in coffee stills. We can see here the image of a coffee still machine, how the distillation is going on. Now, actually, this coffee still machine was invented by Robert Steen, and in the distiller he made it. And actually, the machine he made it is a kind of very simple, but that design was actually presented and modified by Dublin. And as by a Dublin and the person's name is Ennis Coffee. So according to this name, this is termed as coffee stills, and usually it is developed by Robert Steen, but then it is modified by Ennis Coffee. That's why it is termed as coffee still, and it is further modified nowadays, and the distillation usually continues in this coffee still. Okay, now how the distillation will go on?